For example, the RTPSDS seeks to reduce traffic congestion on our roadways so that you could travel to your favorite store in less time. Also, another example is that the RTPSDS seeks to provide more travel options, such as transit or rail transit, so you can commute while avoiding the high gas prices. So now I'm going to like to hand this off to Christine Tran, and she'll go over the agenda for this webinar.
All right. Thank you, Tim. So for today's presentation, I'll cover the first half, like Tim mentioned.
Christine, I think you're on mute.
Oh, can you all hear me?
I can hear you.
Okay, great. All right, so for today's presentation, I'll cover the first half, like Tim mentioned, and I'll talk about SJCOG's role and
Christine, you're still on mute.
I can hear Tim.
I think they can hear me okay. All right. I'll provide a little description about SJCOG and then also cover an overview of the RTP-SES. In the second half of the webinar, Tim will get into the weeds of the RTP-SES and present the proposed strategies and projects within the plan itself. And of course, we've also carved some time for any questions and comments for each of the sections. So I'll go ahead and get started about SJCOG and the RTP-SES. So SJCOG is the San Joaquin Council of Governments. We are a metropolitan planning organization and a joint powers authority comprised of the County of San Joaquin and the listed cities there on the left. SJCOG is overseen by a board of directors who make allocation of funding to build transportation improvements and establish any of the regional transportation policies and programs. We serve the communities in various ways. Some specific examples are listed there. We covered the regional rail, Calvans, RTP-SES, which is what brought us here today, the Regional Housing Needs Assessment, also known as RENA, Measure K, Airport Land Use Commission, and Freeway Service Patrol. The Regional Transportation Plan / Sustainable Community Strategies is a long-range vision and investment plan, as Tim mentioned. It provides a comprehensive look at the future and different transportation needs for the next 30 years in San Joaquin County. The plan is updated every 4 years. The plan maps out how the region will integrate transportation and land use with the ultimate goal of providing transportation options to help the region's anticipated growth. It provides a demonstration of how the region can meet federal and state air quality standards, as well as contributing to the state's housing goals, which is really no surprise that we are in a housing crisis right now. The contribution also is with the state's climate commitment to reducing greenhouse gas emissions and miles driven on the road. The RTP-SES matters. It considers the future population growth and housing needs, as well as economic, environmental, and public health goals. This reflects the plan's importance of investing in transportation infrastructure projects and ensuring the designated fund will keep the region progressing through the future growth patterns. And what I really mean by this is the investments in projects that emphasize freeway congestions on different freeways that we are familiar with, like Freeway 99, 120 or I-205. So for many super commuters that drive out of town on the daily for work and anything like that, the transportation projects could directly impact you. Without SJCOG's board approval in August, then the federal funds utilized for these impactful projects could be delayed. Here I'll cover a little bit about the Senate Bill 375, which is required for MPOs like SJCOG. And the bill covers that there needs to be for us to include a sustainable community strategy in the RCP to show how the region will meet the state's climate goals. SB 375 has some major components, and it's using the RCP process to achieve the reduction in greenhouse gas emission consistent with AB 32's goal. And for some of you that are not familiar with AB 32, it's the California's Global Warming Solution Act. This also, one of the other components is coordinating the regional housing needs allocation process with the regional transportation process while maintaining local authority over land use decisions. So in the process of developing the RTP SES, SJCOG put out MetroQuest surveys and held public workshops that were well attended. From the public participation, the main statement that was gathered was to place more new growth in existing commercial corridors and centers around transit stations rather than greenfield areas. A commercial corridor is important because it's an area along with a major with major roadways that sells a wide variety of goods and services to the community and the surrounding region. From this, SJCOG made adjustments to the plan to fit the statement. The plan's regional transportation investment will go as follows. So 26% is intended for bus transit, and this is an increase around 30% over the previous RTP SES in 2018. And if it gets implemented, much more funding for bus transits will be funded for this area more than before, as mentioned, and more money for buses in the future. 37% for roadway operations, maintenance, and safety. There will be 22% for roadway improvements and expansion. 3% for active transportation and smart growth, which is also increased by 20% over the previous RTP SES. And lastly, 12% for rail transit. So based on these performance metrics, you can see the shift that the plan can make. The 2022's RTP SES will have a significant amount of 5,000 fewer acres of land consumed. And there's over 3,000 fewer acres of prime farmland consumed, so more farmlands can be saved. It also includes 7.1 residential gross density, so neighborhoods will have different housing types of all household incomes, while also having 42% more multi-family housing will be distributed. This also shows there will be a decrease in water consumption and energy use. So now that I provided an overview of SJCOG and a little bit about the RTP SES, we'll do a quick Q&A before we begin our next section of proposed strategies and projects with Tim.
Thanks, Christine. So we just have one question about sharing the presentation. Will that be possible to share with our attendees?
Yes, I think so. That should be fine.
Yeah, we'll email links out shortly, Cynthia. That's all the questions right now.
Okay, I think we're ready to start on the second half of the webinar. So let me use my share screen. Before I start, I just want to remind you that we have provided the URL to our project website. It's in the chat. And if you want to get to look at our draft RTP SES, there's the, like I said, there's a URL that you could get access to our page. And from there, you could see our draft RTP SES. Also, while I'm speaking, if you have any comments, you know, just a reminder, have any comments or questions, please use the chat. And we'll repeat those comments and questions at the end of my portion of the presentation. So proposed strategies, we are proposing about a total of about 30 strategies in our RTP SES. Some of them are strategies from our 2018 plan, but there's a number of new strategies that we're proposing. So I'll be covering some of them in the next slides. And regarding the strategies, these are basically action statements which are going to guide the actions of our agency for the next 3 to 4 to 5 years. So one new strategy that we're proposing is that we will support workforce development efforts across industries. And we're currently trying to establish an electric car share and bike share program in the South Stockton area. An important part of this program is to train young people to do repair and maintenance work on the electric cars and bikes. When I say workforce development, that's basically employee training. We also have a couple strategies that are related to housing. One is that we will encourage the establishment of a regional housing trust fund, and that we will encourage the streamlining of the development process. The Regional Housing Trust Fund is where we're proposing that all of our member agencies would charge a development fee on building permits for commercial projects. And this building permit fee will be used for affordable housing. At least that's what we're planning or proposing. And then streamlining the development process, we're going to encourage our member agencies to make changes to their zoning codes or their permit processing, and that would hopefully result in more housing being developed. So we did receive a grant from the State Housing and Community Development Department. That grant requires us to bring forward regional housing priorities. In fact, we did bring forward those priorities to our board last September, and they approved those housing priorities. And two of those regional housing priorities are the two proposed strategies that you see on this slide. One thing about the grant, it enables us to provide funds to our member agencies, you know, the cities and the county, to make changes in their zoning code or other regulatory documents in order to encourage more housing development. And then another new strategy I'd like to cover this afternoon is we will invest in high-speed internet infrastructure. As you probably know, there's a lot of areas in the county that lack high-speed internet infrastructure, or there's some areas I think that lack high-speed internet service period, particularly in the rural areas. So we did complete recently a transportation innovation planning study. As part of this pilot project for the study, we have prepared a fiber readiness plan, which is essentially a checklist of best practices in order to assist our member agencies to install high-speed internet infrastructure within their jurisdiction. So if you currently lack high-speed internet infrastructure, hopefully that will change within the next several years. So now I'm gonna go over the proposed projects that are included in our RTP SCS. We do have a list of transportation investments that are basically, the projects are required to be included in the RTP SCS. If they're not included, then they would not basically be qualified to receive federal state funds. So it's very important that these projects be on our list. And I have to emphasize that these projects only have identified funding sources. That's how they qualify to be on our list. These projects don't necessarily have any funds available for construction. So one project I like to cover is the I-205 project. And this project originally started as including some HOV or carpool lanes on I-205. Instead, this project has kind of morphed into providing a hot lanes or express lanes. HOT stands for high occupancy toll lanes. Because we were looking at this because of the success of the express lanes on I-580 and the growing congestion on I-205. Of course, if you do currently commute to the Bay Area by way of 205, you're going to benefit from this because this will definitely reduce the congestion. But the downside, of course, is that it's going to possibly increase your transportation costs because you'll be paying a toll for use of the freeway. Another portion of this project is looking at the median strip between the two roadways of I-205. And there's various options that are being looked at to use this median strip, and this is going to most likely be used for future multimodal options such as transit or other types of transportation. So it could be used for reversible lanes or autonomous vehicle lanes. This median strip could be used for bus only lanes. We're also looking at this strip being used for passenger rail and also for park and ride lots and transit stations. And then another major project that is included in our RTP SDS, and there's different phases for this project. I think there's at least three phases. And this is the junction of State Route 99 with State Route 120. And as you know, there's a lot of congestion that's occurring because of the particular intersection just can't handle the traffic. In fact, I've heard that the traffic goes all the way down to the city of Ripon, and this project is located in Manteca. So we're hoping that the project proponents could make drastic improvements to this particular junction that will result in improved safety and general circulation. Also, right now, this junction is basically an obstacle for our truck traffic. It's creating a lot of bottlenecks. In fact, a lot of trucks are using the nearby neighborhoods to cut through the neighborhoods and avoid this particular junction. Then there's the ACE Forward project. The Railroad Commission is proposing to extend this rail service to the city of Merced, which will result in a number of expansion projects of existing train stations. Also, there's going to be new train stations in the city of Manteca and also in the city of Ripon. So if you live in these particular cities, Manteca or Ripon, and currently commute by car by way of I-205 to the Bay Area, this project is probably going to really benefit you. That provide you another option for your commute. And then there's the Valley Link project. And this project is in our RTP SCS, at least the very first phase of this project within the region. The purpose of the Valley Link project is to connect the ACE train service with the BART train service in the Bay Area. And so the project that's included in RTP SCS is the Mountain House station that's located near Mountain House. It includes, of course, the station and also a relatively large parking lot. Then, of course, there's a lot of, in our project list, there's a lot of transit projects, bus transit projects. They pertain to capital improvements, such as increasing the size of transit stations or adding more bus stops or, including more buses, purchasing more buses. And then also these are related to operations as well and to making the system more efficient. And so we have a lot of projects in our RTP SCS that are related to bus transit that where I think most of the transit providers do have at least one project in our RTP SCS. Now the project timeline is that we are near the end of this project. This project has been going on for over 2.5 years. We are anticipating to bring forward this project to our board in late August after a regular board meeting. And so we're within a 55-day public review period. So this period is going to continue until August 1st. It started on June 7th. So once again, if you want to take a look at our RTP SCS, please look at the URL in the chat and copy that, and you can get access to the RTP SCS by way of our website. There's a couple of ways for you to comment on our draft RTP SCS. Just a reminder again that the public comment period is going to end on Monday, August 1st. You can make a comment at one of our public hearings. In fact, I'll be giving you more information about those in the next slide. Also, you could email us at rtp@sjcog.org. And finally, you could mail me your comments using the address that's on this slide. And then regarding the public hearings, The first public hearing did happen already. That happened last week. But we do have another public hearing that's going to occur on July 22nd at 12 p.m. That's going to be a virtual Zoom meeting with our executive committee of our board of directors. So now we have time for more questions and comments. Isaiah, did we receive any questions or comments?
Yeah, thanks, Tim. We have a couple questions. First, I'd like to just ask the panelists just to drop in the chat real quick how you came to find out about this webinar, whether it was email or in person. That would be great and helpful for us. So the first question from Chris is kind of two parts. So what connection does the SCS have with high-speed internet? And is it thought that there would be more remote working to reduce VMT?
Yes, one of our, we're required in our, particularly with our RTP, our regional transportation plan, to address a number of issues, not just transportation, but one of those issues is economic development. And of course, high-speed internet is essential to have more economic development in our region. There's probably going to be more businesses with employees that are going to be working at home more. I think that's going to be that's going to be a trend that's going to continue after the pandemic. So, we got to have high-speed internet infrastructure to support those workers that are, working at home, even though, particularly those workers that, have their offices in the Bay Area. High-speed internet is also required for or needed because we're assuming that there's probably going to be more people shopping from home. A good example is my wife. My wife, she does all her shopping now almost totally by way of the internet. And of course she could drive, but it's a lot more convenient. So it's most likely that we're gonna have more people using internet services, and buy things from Amazon. So I think those are gonna be two long range trends that's gonna continue after pandemic. There's gonna be more commuters that are going to be working at home, telecommuters, and also there's going to be more e-shoppers that are going to be using, internet services rather than going out and shopping.
Okay, thanks, Tim. So the next question, is there any discussion to connect proposed projects in the RTP to high-speed rail in the Valley?
Well, the short answer is no. I'm not aware of any, with the ACE train or with the Valley Link to connect, high speed rail with the existing rail systems, whether it's going to be the ACE train or the future Valley Link service. If anybody out there who knows something that maybe I don't know, please use the chat and maybe you could give us an update on that. But to my knowledge, no, there is no, has not been any discussions to my knowledge between linking the high-speed rail service with the, with ACE train or with the future Valley Link service.
All right, thank you. Now, can you provide a summary of the strategies proposed to reduce the truck cut-through traffic for the 99 and 120 project goals?
Well, I'm not involved with that project, but I could certainly do some research. I could contact the staff people who are familiar with that project, and I could send you information about maybe any public outreach there has been for regarding the project to the surrounding neighborhoods, and also if there's been any mitigation measures that has been determined yet for that particular situation. So if you want to send us your email address, I could get back to you on that. I think I know who to ask about that. One of our staff members, most likely, is going to be Ryan Nieblock. So, please send us your email address. I'll try to get back to you as soon as possible on that.
Okay, she did drop it in the chat, so we have
that. Okay, thank you.
Are there any other questions? Raise hands, drop them in the chat. Now is the time. Christine, got a question for you. Can you explain some of SJCOG's public outreach efforts?
Yeah, I'd be happy to. So for some of our outreach efforts, we have done the working group, some public workshops that Tim mentioned earlier, some community-based organization and city presentations. So some of like educational presentations and discussing with RTP is. We've also done some online surveys, public hearings. And one of the big ones I feel like is tabling at community events. So we were tabling at places like the Earth Day event at Victory Park, the Conway Home events, and much more. So yeah, we've done quite some field outreach efforts in the last year or two.
Thank you. Tim, can you expand a little bit more on some of the strategies? Are there any more strategies in the document other than the three that you mentioned?
Yeah, I think I stated earlier that we're proposing a total of 30 strategies. And of course, most of them are related to transportation, but because of the federal requirements and also state requirements now, as you probably know, we need to focus more, not just on, not just on transportation, but other issues as well. Because of SB 375, which was passed by the state legislature several years ago, we are required to focus also on land use, since there's such a close relationship between land use and transportation. So, and because of that, we also are focusing more and more on housing as well. And as I stated before, we are required by the feds to also focus on economic development issues, and more and more we need to we have to focus on public health issues as well, and then because of the requirements for environmental justice, we have to, that's directly related to public health. So a lot of our strategies still are related to transportation, but more and more, as time goes along, not just this RTP SCS, but I'm sure in future RTP SCSs, we're gonna have more strategies that are related to land use, economic development, environmental justice, and public health.
Great. Thanks, Tim. We don't have any more questions at this time. Suppose we could wrap it up now. Thanks everybody for joining. Got 30 minutes left to give back to you. We'll post the recording on our website on the project page that I've linked in the chat. And you all can enjoy the rest of your day. I hope it's fantastic. Thanks, everyone.